The first populist government in Western Europe. Can it solve Italy's problems? The coalition of the far right and anti-establishment parties ends months of political uncertainty. But is it a threat to the European Union? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the program. I'm Folly by Thibault. A very unusual coalition government has come to power in Italy. Leaders of the anti-establishment five-star movement and the right-wing anti-immigration league party have been sworn into office, ending 3 months of political deadlock. They want to revive Italy's sluggish economy by rejecting austerity and increasing spending, proposals which have worried the European Union because of Italy's large debt. So, what will this government, led by law professor Giuseppe Conte, mean for Italy and the rest of Europe? We'll put that question to our guests in just a moment. But first, Nadine Baba has our report from Rome.
Handing over to the new prime minister, Paolo Gentiloni makes way for law professor Giuseppe Conte, marking the first time Italy's so-called populists have been in government.
I swear to be loyal to the Republic, to faithfully respect its constitution and its laws, and to exercise my role in the exclusive interest of the Republic.
The financial markets here have reacted positively to the new government, with shares in Italian banks gaining more than 3% on Friday. But this is unknown territory for Italy, and the new administration is promising big changes.
The incoming Interior Minister Matteo Salvini, head of the far-right League, wants to expel hundreds of thousands of undocumented migrants. He's recently talked about setting up detention centres across the country. While his equally ambitious rival, five-star leader Luigi Di Maio, who'll be Labour and Industry Minister, has promised a basic minimum income. Then there's how Italy will interact with the European Union. Paolo Savona, a Eurosceptic prevented from being economy minister just days ago, would be in charge of EU affairs. And Giovanni Tria, the replacement economy minister, has criticised Germany and called for changes in EU fiscal rules to allow more state investment.
Tria can be a bit more of a diplomat, and they play the good cop, bad cop, role play. But in any case, what we have to expect from the two men and from this government is a much more vocal standing of Italy, I wouldn't say against Europe, but in face of Europe. And this is what is worrying somehow international observers.
The new cabinet should easily pass a vote of confidence expected early next week. But the real test will be whether this highly unusual coalition can hold together and push for reforms that many voters expect and many EU leaders fear. Nadine Baba, Al Jazeera, Rome.
Well, let's bring in our guests for today's Inside Story. Joining us from Rome, Federigo Argentieri, professor of political science at the John Cabot University in Rome. From Brussels by Skype is Daniel Gros, director of the Center for European Policy Studies, and also in Rome, Nathalie Tocci, director of the Italian Institute of International Affairs and special advisor to the EU's foreign policy chief, Federica Mogherini. Thank you all for being on the program. We appreciate your time. Federico, in Rome, if I can start with you. So the markets are breathing easier after the coming to power of this new coalition government in Italy. But is this government good news for Italy, and is it representative of the Italian people?
It's a tricky question. The first question is tricky. The second is not. It is certainly representative of the Italian people, because the two parties of the coalitions have collected an absolute majority combined, have collected an absolute majority of votes. Whether it is good or bad, if you're asking me personally, I don't think it's very good, but I'm a voter as many others, and my opinion counts up to a certain point. We will see what they will be able to do.
Mm. Nathalie, your thoughts? These are very strange bedfellows. Can this alliance of the five-star movement and the Northern League last long enough to make a dent in the political and economic life of Italy, especially when you consider that virtually no Italian government has survived for 5 years? Can they last together?
Well, I think there's a sort of part of the answer has to do with policy, and second part of the answer has to do with politics. Mm-hmm. I think when it comes to policy, the issue in my mind really is, to what extent are these two parties moving forward going to develop their stances on what I would define as a vertical, if you like, open-closed axis, or rather as on the basis of a horizontal left-right axis. Now, if the latter comes to play, then indeed the tensions between these two parties are set to grow, because it's very clear that the Lega lies very squarely on the extreme right, mm-hmm. As is clear that the Five Star Movement is basically split. I would put this more or less on a 60-40 basis, 60 towards the left, 40 towards the right. So if this develops horizontally, if you like, left-right, tensions are inevitably going to grow. If instead they move forward by articulating their policies rather on the basis of a vertical open-closed axis, then actually, and this is the more worrying part of the story, both are actually quite comfortable on the closed camp. And what I mean by the closed camp is anything that goes from trade to attitudes towards Europe, right, to migration, basically sees them on a nationalist stance. But then, of course, the other part of the question is the more political side. And this will probably be determined to a large extent on the support basis, right, and the support of these two parties moving forward.
All right, let's get Daniel's views in Brussels. Daniel, as Nathalie said there, there are a lot of differences between these two parties in this coalition government. There are many rivalries even between the two leading figures of the coalition government, Matteo Salvini and Luigi Di Maio. Who's going to be really in charge, you think?
Well, I think these two will be in charge. And they have a common interest. A common interest is to stay in power. I do not think they care so much about what actually policies they can implement, as long as they can say, we are here, we are the clean new expression of the people. The old governments were of the old elite, which has to be put into the dustbin. And that common desire will unify them and will make them probably stick together. So in that sense, I could very well see lasting this government for quite a long time.
But what kind of a program, Daniel, are they going to be pushing through?
Well, that is the big question everybody asks here in Brussels. Will they actually insist on implementing their fiscal program, which would mean less taxes and more expenditure? And we all know that's not possible. Question is, when will they acknowledge reality? Do we have to have a financial crisis before they actually acknowledge reality? And I think what happened over this week has been a salutary reminder for them that you cannot just only spend. And therefore, my prediction would be that there will be lots of theatrics, lots of clashes with Brussels, but in the end, the fiscal policy will not be that imprudent.
All right. We'll take a further look at the implications for the European Union in just a few minutes, but I just want to get Federico's thoughts in Rome on the domestic challenges ahead for this new government. Federico, the new Italian Interior Minister, Matteo Salvini, the head of the League, is very tough on immigration and has talked about expelling hundreds of thousands of undocumented migrants. He's talked about setting up detention centres around the country to house asylum seekers. Luigi Di Maio, on the other hand, the new Labour and Industry Minister, has talked about establishing a basic universal income and cutting taxes. Now, given Italy's huge debt, can they afford to push through with these policies?
Interesting question again. I think you should ask Giovanni Tria, the new Minister of the Economy, who is an independent, a so-called technician, that is, he's an expert and doesn't really belong to any of the two factions. He will try to combine those very different platforms together. And I have no idea of how he will be able to do so, because, as you've said, the income, the so-called citizenship income, to translate the Italian version, is a very dangerous commodity for a country that has such a big deficit as Italy. Where will the resources be extracted from is a good question. And there are serious expectations for this promise to be delivered. I think Mr. Di Maio knows that if he doesn't deliver within at least a year, maximum a year, he will run into trouble with his constituency. Now, with regards to Mr. Salvini, it's very rhetorically very aggressive, but I think he will have to come to terms with the existing situation and find out that the previous government over the past year or so has not handled the immigration issue badly.
Right.
I think he will grow more realistic. There is one more thing, if you allow me, that I would like to add. Nobody speaks too much about civil rights and the new minister of the family, Mr. Fontana. Mm-hmm. I think if there's trouble coming, it will come from there, because Mr. Fontana is notoriously against the civil rights. He will try to roll back legislation in various domains, family and same sex and so on and so forth. And this will certainly present troublesome consequences as far as the reaction of the people is concerned.
Nathalie, do you agree with that? Federico says trouble will come from the civil rights and the civil rights issues. And I also want to get your thoughts on, their plan to reduce Italy's debt. They're talking about what they call the revival of internal demand and by not continuing austerity. Can it work to reduce Italy's debt?
Well, I mean, let me comment on all three. I mean, I think on the civil rights issue, I think this is key. I completely agree with the assessment, and I actually think this is going to be one of the issues which is going to sort of exacerbate tensions between these two movements.
Right.
When it comes to debt and economic policy in general, I'm with Daniel there. It's very clear that, there's a big wish list there. Mind you, some of these wishes, if we take, for instance, the request not to include public investments in the calculations for the deficit, this has been an old Italian demand. I mean, the point is, what do you do when the answer to your demands is no? And here is where there's the broader question about the Europeanism of this government. If the answer is no, do you simply accept to remain as part of the European game or not? And this is where the whole crisis with the previous sort of quasi-appointment of Savona as economy minister came out. To the extent that there was doubt in the president of the republic that the fallback position would have been an exit, then the president, rightly so, put a number of markers there to prevent Italy from sliding into the abyss. So I agree that ultimately there's going to be lots of screaming and shouting, but not much will change.
Right.
Mind you, I think a very similar argument can be made about migration.
Right.
Again, revising the Dublin regulation has been an old Italian demand, in many respects, for very good reason. But the point is, what do you actually do when the answer coming from the rest of the EU member states is no?
All right. Let's look at the wider implications now for Europe of this new Italian government, the first populist government, as we've said, in Western Europe. Populism is gaining strength in different parts of the European continent, according to the Tony Blair Institute for Global Change. It analysed the electoral results of 102 populist parties in 39 European countries over the last 8 years. And the study shows that the number of populist parties in Europe has almost doubled since 2000, and nearly three quarters are right-wing. Populists are in power in seven Eastern European countries: Bosnia, Bulgaria, the Czech Republic, Hungary, Poland, Serbia and Slovakia. In Western Europe, they're less prominent and part of the government of only two countries, as a junior coalition partner in Austria and part of the Swiss Federal Council in Switzerland. In Scandinavia, they've won increasing shares of the vote in Denmark and Sweden, and they're represented in the governments of Finland and Norway. Populist parties in Southern Europe tend to be more leftist, the study singled out Greece, where the Syriza party is in power. Daniel, I know you've written extensively about this, Europe's populist parties and right-wingers cheering the new Italian government. Can the EU survive this rise of populism?
Well, that is the big question. I think it will survive in the end, but it will be a tough ride. By the way, Italy is a curious path, example of having both right-wing and left-wing populism within one country, which actually is natural given that the northern part of Italy is quite well off, industrialized. That is more like northern Europe, whereas the southern part of Italy is in conditions which are not far from those of Greece. So within one country, you have both left and right-wing populists, and they form a government. They unite in their desire to do something different, to show that they will not accept EU constraints. And the easy question is, or the difficult question for them is, how long can they actually do that until reality bumps up against them? And that is, I think, when the EU will become more popular again, when people see that the EU might just be the only solution to what the problems we are facing in the European continent.
Do you think that eventually they'll have to fall in line with EU rules, or is Italy's EU membership really at risk here, as some have said?
I don't think that membership is at risk, but what is in the question now is, when will people realize that the constraints which come from EU membership, for example, in the economic and financial sphere, that these constraints actually help the country to become more stable? That austerity might sound bad, but in the end, with a country that has such a large debt, you don't have much of a choice to do it anyway. And if it's not the EU which enforces it, it will be financial markets. Mm. And people have to understand that. As long as they don't, they will rebel against the EU. Once they have understood that this is just a fact of life they cannot get away with, then maybe they will see that actually within the EU umbrella, it is easier to deal with this problem.
Federico, in Rome, your thoughts. Some would say this is a slap in the face of the EU, but is the bloc itself at risk with the rise of these populist parties and now this first populist government in Western Europe?
I am optimistic in the longer run. And we also have the example of Greece. Greece was terribly hit by the austerity measures dictated by Brussels, inevitably dictated, not because Brussels is a dictator, but because Greece has decided to stay within the EU because every other alternative has been viewed by the people of Greece as negative. So we have the example of Greece, and I think that based on that example, I don't think any country besides the UK, which, however, was not in the euro, so it's a completely different issue, I don't think any other country will walk out or even get any closer to walking out. But blood, sweat, tears are ahead of all of us in terms of austerity measures and need to fix many aspects of the situation. So I don't see the EU at risk, but I see it going through a long phase of adjustment and hopefully not economic. The country of growth now, the word is not coming. Economic decrease, hopefully not.
Okay.
Hopefully the economy will grow again sooner or later, which will, of course, boost up the optimism and the hopes for a brighter future.
Nathalie, not a lot of optimism right now. I know you work closely with the European Union's foreign policy chief. If a major country like Italy, which is one of the founding members, in fact, of the EU, was to go against EU rules, how big of a problem would that be for the bloc?
Obviously, it would be a massive problem, but I must say that I really don't think this is going to happen. Mm. I think that indeed, this is going to be a rough ride, and I completely agree with what has been said. But I actually, in an odd kind of way, given that we are in an age of nationalist populism, the point is, how do we exorcise and eventually defeat the phenomenon? And in this respect, I think that the role that institutions have to play, be it both national and, of course, European, is absolutely key. And in many respects, if one is to see the silver lining of this particular drama that Italy is going through at the moment, it's precisely the story that the excesses of this government have been actually so far contained in the formation of the government by the president. Institutions still hold. Mm-hmm. This is true at national level. It has proved to be true at national level. The point really is, how will the European level, how will European institutions, rules and regulations also contribute to containing these excesses and rechanneling, if you like, Italy towards a different path? And indeed, a rough ride it will be, but I'm actually fairly confident that there will not be a break here.
All right. Daniel, are you as confident? I mean, the EU is no doubt reeling from the double shock of Brexit and the election of Donald Trump. Now it's also having possibly to deal with a trade war with the United States with these latest tariffs imposed by the Trump administration. How does the EU, ride this wave, all the different challenges that are coming its way? How does the EU defeat, as Nathalie said, how do they defeat populism, this new populism phenomenon?
Well, the EU cannot really defeat populism. Populism has to defeat itself by actually going to excesses, and then people have to see that it doesn't lead anywhere. That's the only way really it can be defeated, not by fiat from Brussels. Mm-hmm. But in a certain way, the EU has been pushed together. The remaining EU has been pushed together by Trump, to some extent by Brexit. And I think the similar thing is happening in the financial sphere by Italy. All the other countries in the Union are seeing what happens if you think that you can announce great fiscal expansions without having the money for it. That's why countries like Spain, Portugal, Ireland, others which have had a crisis are saying never again, and we certainly don't side with Italians. So the Italians will be rather isolated. And they will feel that actually what they want to do cannot be done. And in the end, in this sense, I think the current framework for the euro might become stronger than before.
But they have to have reforms within the European Union, don't they? I mean, if they are to survive these various challenges that we've mentioned, they have to have reforms. Do you think they're ready to have those reforms?
That's the negative aspect of what is going on right now. It has become impossible to have actually a meaningful reform of the euro area, of fiscal policy, because with a large country like Italy having a government in which you have parties which have thought maybe we will exit, maybe we will not honor our debt, maybe we will not our treaties which we have signed beforehand, how can you ask the Germans, match the French and the other Northern Europeans to conclude new agreements which rely on rules which maybe in the end a country like Italy will not respect. Mm. And therefore, I think de facto we have to admit that the reform of the euro area will be put on hold until the situation in Italy has been cleared up.
All right. Federico, in Rome, I'll give you the last word. Different challenges that the European Union is faced with right now, not just within, but also external challenges, like perhaps a looming trade war with the United States. Do you think the Europeans can stay united, can be united and strong enough to weather these challenges?
If you ask me if I am optimistic, I'm optimistic in the long run. But as I said, there will be a lot of difficulties. And as you noticed when reviewing the state of populist movements throughout Europe, Sweden is at risk to some extent because the Democrats in Sweden, the so-called Democrats, which are the populist party, might gain a lot of seats in September when the elections are due. It's the next possible, element of novelty, so mm-hmm. to speak. But on the other hand, I would like to address the question of what to do. What to do face this new challenge is to accept the challenge and understand the failures the failures of the pro-Europe, pro-globalization elite, as it is called by the populists. It's not an elite, but it is called an elite.
Okay.
There is no understanding, no deep understanding of everything that happened, there will not be any possibility of fixing this situation.
We'll leave it there. Thank you so very much for a very interesting discussion. Federigo Argentieri, Daniel Gros and Nathalie Tocci, thank you for being on this edition of Inside Story. And thank you as well for watching. Don't forget, you can always watch this program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. For further discussion, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can, of course, join the conversation on Twitter as well. Our handle is @AJInsideStory. From me, Folly, Thibault, and the whole team, thank you for watching. Bye for now.